One, two. One, one, two. Check. One. No. One, one, two. One, one, two. Check. One, one. One, two, check. One, two, one, two.
Thank you. closest to his family.
Of the family, but members of the public later on, after 11 o'clock, filing past the mortal remains of Sir Frederick. The members of the family are here this morning, and as mentioned earlier, they arrived upstairs. Some of them were here before as we arrived at the assembly chamber, and others were waiting for the arrival of the mortal remains of Sir Frederick, and the pallbearers, members of the Royal St. Vincent and the Grenadines Police Force, and also of the SVG Coast Guard Service, brought the remains on the floor of the Parliament, where under normal circumstances we'll have the meeting of the House. But today it's one of those occasions where this hall has been repurposed for the purpose of the laying to rest and the paying of last respects to a senior statesman, a man who served selflessly to his country, to the world, as he not only touched persons in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but those abroad, even more so before he became Governor General in the capacity of a medical doctor. And Abigail, you do remember many of those tributes that were shared even up to this morning. We had persons calling and sharing just an outpour of support for the family and a sad state, a state of mourning as it regards the passing of Sir Frederick.
And persons paid their respects and tribute and remember the fact that he helped a lot of persons, and you know, persons didn't just remember him as the Governor General and as a medical doctor, but as a friend, someone they could confide in, someone they could go and, you know, talk to and ask for advice, someone who would help them if it is that they're in need of a job. He would help them in that area as well, in terms of guidance and certain things. He would be the person to go to. I remember listening this morning to one of the tributes where it was said that, you know, one of the persons who worked with them in terms of taking care of his daughter, Melissa, that they would have conversations, you know, as she said, they would reason, you know. And it just really goes to show the type of man he was, one who was very genuine in wanting to help persons and not just help, but really listen. And indeed, he will be greatly missed. He was a man who had a ready smile when you met him anywhere. And just to give a brief background of Sir Frederick, he started out in medicine, of course, as we would have heard over the last couple of days and even before. He completed initial degree in chemistry at the Howard University in Washington, D.C. and then went to the sunny upstate medical university in New York to study medicine. The sole black individual enrolled in the medical school during that time. Valentine was elected to student government in the very year of his degree, and in his final year was elected student body president. He interned at the Montreal General Hospital after graduation, and then completed his residency in internal medicine in Rochester, New York, followed by a fellowship in cardiology. He returned to St. Vincent and the Grenadines in 1971.
And Sir Frederick started his contribution long before he became a Governor General in the medical field in particular. That is what he was known for. He was a specialist in that area. And his contribution there has been reflected on so many times over the last few days. The callers would say, you know, I had a problem, a medical problem, and nobody else could tell me, you know, how to address this. Who do I go to? Where can I find a specialist? And on a one-on-one basis, he was able to arrange for them to travel overseas, to have surgeries done, to have a specialist attend to their medical need. And we've heard that numerous occasions between the program we aired on Sunday, the tribute program, and of course this morning, and through the other reflections that we've heard as well. For those who are joining us by way of radio, just to give you an idea as to what's happening, just a few minutes ago we had Her Excellency, the Governor General, current Governor General, Mrs. Susan Duggan, file past the body and paying her respects and greeting members of the immediate family as well. And then just after that, his daughters, Sir Frederick's daughters and other relatives also pay their respects. What we're having now is the Speaker of the House of Assembly, Mr. Joma Thomas. He's just passed the mortal remains of Sir Frederick and greeting the family. The Honourable Prime Minister is accompanied this morning by Mrs. Gonzales. And just the emotion, the facial expression of the Prime Minister. And he did speak very highly of Sir Frederick, as everyone did. And this morning, his expression is one of a really sad, as if you've lost a brother, a relative. And he's extending his regards now to the family. Shortly, we have the Speaker of the OECS House of Assembly, Honourable René Batisse, who is in the process of viewing the remains of Sir Frederick. And she too paid her respects in hosting that tribute on Sunday on NBC Radio. And we were able to capture a lot of what Sir Frederick was like from people who knew him long before we were even born. And we have persons who interacted with him 30 years ago, 35, 40 years ago, 50 years ago for that matter. And you hear that it is not as recent as him becoming a senior statesman that he's had a reputation of being a humble man, a man of trust, a man that you can confide in, as you mentioned, Abigail. And it is just who he was. It wasn't a matter of putting on an appearance for the sake of consumption. It was a matter where he was a genuine person, in private life and in public life. So, during this hour, we expect to have other senior government officials, members of parliament, and otherwise, persons viewing the body of Sir Frederick. And we just imagine the difficulty of the family this morning. Yes, we know that Sir Frederick had been ill, but no one is ever prepared for death. It might be a case where someone is ill, but the loss of someone this time is of course, a difficult one to deal with at any time. The viewing by the officials will, of course, continue shortly. And with that, we'll make way for the viewing by the public, which is expected to last until midday. And just a reminder, if you're planning to come by to pay your last respects, there are certain protocols involved, the address code, for example. And we would want to remind you that you, because of where you will be, it is required that you dress according to the occasion, and you will be reminded if that is not abided by those who are receiving you. But we know that many persons might be in Kingstown doing business today. Today has been declared a half holiday for public sector workers, statutory bodies, and non-essential staff. But I've noticed, and since that declaration was done, many private sector businesses have decided to also pay their, as a mark of respect, close their operations at midday today, and some at 1, to facilitate persons who wish to attend and pay their respects.
And as you mentioned, Colvin, it wasn't just the fact that persons are paying tribute to him, knowing him as Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but from previous years, knowing him as a medical doctor. And just to continue with a background of this great man, one who has been named a very humble and genuine soul, he, as I mentioned earlier, he returned to St. Vincent and the Grenadines in 1971. He was the most highly trained physician on the island at that time. He was consequently appointed Chief of Medicine at the newly constructed Kingstown General Hospital, which is now being called Milton Cato Memorial Hospital. Ballantyne oversaw upgrades to the facilities of both the hospital and regional health clinics, with one of his first priorities being to expand the hospital's immunization program. He also instituted the hospital's visiting specialist program, which recruited overseas medical specialists to volunteer in St. Vincent's hospitals in exchange for free accommodation in the country's resorts. And of course, coming along on the heels of that, we now see today the operations of the World Pediatric Project, and the wonderful work that they are doing through that project, partnering with the doctors from the US and so forth, who come on a regular basis for different medical treatments for children, not just here in St. Vincent, but also in the Caribbean region. He served in the position of St. Vincent's Chief Medical Officer until 1992. So that was quite a span of his work, from 1971 thereabout, when he, upon his return, to 1992. He remained involved in the medicine after his official retirement from practicing in a consulting role. And we would have heard as well tributes being paid from nurses and working along with him throughout the years. And I remember this morning as well, a nurse saying that, you know, he never left without saying thank you. You know, and that just really speaks to the type of man that he was. Sir Frederick, outside of his career in the medical field, he had a business interest in several other areas. And prior to his appointment as Governor General, he served as the president of the Millennium Bank, an offshore bank registered here in St. Vincent. And he was also the president of an international pharmaceutical company in Barbados. He was also the founder of International Business Services Limited, BIS, and a financial services provider, now being run by his son Marcus and a co-owner of Young Island Resort here in St. Vincent.
We welcome those who are listening by way of NBC Radio, those who are viewing by way of NBC's Facebook page, facebook.com/NBCSVG. Those who are viewing by way of VC3 television and VC3's live online stream as well. And to those who are viewing by way of SVG television, who's joining us for the broadcast as well this morning, we welcome you to our official coverage of the state funeral of Sir Frederick Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, a man who served this country for many years, and even up to the point of him demitting office, he continued in his service in the capacity of Governor General. Sir Frederick is survived by 8 children, and all of whom spoke so highly of him. In the last few days, we've heard, especially from his daughter, Lauren, who is the executive director of the World Pediatric Project, and to tell you how humble Sir Frederick was, he has never wanted the recognition associated with the WPP, as much as he is one of the persons who spearheaded the WPP's presence in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. He thought that it was something that he had to do for his country, for the children. And the WPP has gone on to help thousands of children, not just in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but the entire region. And if I may say, I too benefited from the services of the WPP. So this today touches me even more than any other event that I've had to do the duties of a live broadcast. And I was mentioning earlier to his daughter that I've been doing live broadcasts for over 10 years, inclusive of at least 4 or 5 funerals. And this is by far the most difficult one for me, because he was a man I met relatively recently in person. And we've had conversations, we've had exchanges, you know, and he showed great appreciation for what I do, and he also offered great encouragement. And we actually had said that we will meet and chat again soon. Last time we met late last year, but that wasn't to be, and he, of course, was ailing for some time, and he wasn't a man who spoke a lot about the fact that he was ill. He just wanted to have his quietness and for the work to go on, hence the reason he demitted office for health reasons and handed the baton over to our now Governor General, the first female Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Her Excellency Mrs. Susan Duggan. And Abigail, if we can point out how humble this gentleman was, it was requested that he be buried in a breadfruit wooden coffin built from breadfruit tree. And it is not a matter of purchasing the most expensive casket you can find. If he deserved it, of course he deserved it, as he served in the most senior position as a statesman, and all credits was due to him. But he was a man who thought about others and about the decisions even after death, the cost factor, you know, it would have as it relates to sending him off. He just wanted as simple as possible of a send off, and his family honored his request. And today before us we see a coffin that embodies him in so many ways, how humble he was, and how simple he was of a man. As the mourners from the SVG Cadet Force flanking both ends of the coffin, and persons are filing by slowly. We haven't had a continuous flow of officials coming by, but we expect as it gets closer to 11 that you'll have more and more of the members of parliament, senior civil servants, etc., coming by and paying their last respects. We've already had Her Excellency the Governor General and the Honourable Prime Minister and the Speaker of the House, Speaker of the OECS, House of Assembly as well, also paid her respects. And Abigail, it is going to be quite a long day for us, I know, for our team, as we are mandated to pay our respects to a man who has served not just as Governor General, but as a medical practitioner for many years, and who has served and touched the lives of countless. It's almost impossible, if not impossible, for us to count the individuals, the amount of persons that Sir Frederick touched in his, what I would say, short time on earth. He died at 83, and he had been serving for well over half a century. And I'm sure that many who are listening today or viewing today can reflect on some way, in some way, and how they interacted and how he touched their lives, whether personally or otherwise.
And not just persons here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but many persons abroad as well. And, you know, someone was saying, not too long ago, I think it was probably on Monday, that we can emulate his life, and in a time, in a day and age when we see, you know, a lot of things happening. We have recently what's happening in the Asian side of the world, where we having persons who are dying from the coronavirus. Him being a part of the medical field, I'm quite sure he would have been interested to see, you know, how he could have helped, you know, in that area. But not just that, the type of man he was, we can all take a page from his book, you know, how gentle and genuine, how humble he was, how quick he was to give a lending ear. And that speaks volumes to the type of man that he was. And you know, the person was really saying that we can all take a page from his book in terms of how we respond, how we treat others, how we live as a people, and not just here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but wherever we go in life, and always to live a life of service. And this morning someone sent a message saying that, you know, he's an example of how to live in service with love, you know. And I, this morning when we came to the parliament, I greeted his daughter Melissa and Lauren, and Melissa was saying, did you know that my dad loved your morning show? So I said, what? She says, yes, you know, my dad really loved your morning show. And I got a bit choked up because I never knew. And he was just an amazing man. I met him a couple times, but, you know, I was able to speak with him briefly at one time. And he looked at me and he had a very ready smile on his face. And he said, young lady, how are you? You know, and, you know, he was just a very genuine, lovely, lovely man. And I really hope and pray that during this time that we would all reflect on the life that he lived, the example that he lived, and as Colvin mentioned, having the highest rank in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, that we would really reflect on his life and look at how he lived and try in some way to emulate the example that he left for us.
And as someone said in a text message during the tributes, if you looked in the dictionary next to the meaning of the word humble, there's a possibility you would see Sir Frederick's name, and that he was the very definition of being humble. And many persons reflected on that over the last few days. But I remember the first time I interacted with him, he said, "But I love to listen to you on the radio. I listened, and I was blown away. I didn't realize that the Governor General had been following so closely what we were doing. I know he would be listening, but his daughters would tell you that he was always glued to his radio, for want of a better expression, and NBC Radio was his choice. And Javel, one of our announcers, reflected as well that he had a call from him even while he was Governor General, and she didn't quite recognize that it was him. And she did eventually, and he was commenting about the quality of her music and the fact that she was a young person with an old soul. And I'm sure Javel remembers that as well, and that was shared by her in the last few days. So we know that to us at NBC, he was also dear to us, not just because he was a senior statesman and he was a Governor General. He was also a man that provided feedback, provided encouragement to us, our on-air team. And I wouldn't doubt that many other members of our team received calls from him, maybe not even knowing that it's him, from time to time, and commenting about the music and the content that was being put out. But Abigail, not a very widely known fact, but I think it came out in our tribute on Sunday, that Dr. Ballantyne, as he was before he was knighted in 2002, served as a medical director of the Kingstown General Hospital. And he served in that capacity for a while, until he was then appointed chief medical officer from 1985 to 1992. He was in charge of the entire health sector, the health services in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. So you see, 1971, when he returned from Syracuse and Howard University, he began a service that never ended. Because up to the point of his passing, he was of service to the country. And the Kingstown General Hospital has since been renamed the Milton Cato Memorial Hospital. And Dr. Ballantyne, as he was, continued his outstanding contribution to the health sector. We hear the many stories of persons who received help from him, some sort of direction. They went to so many persons years ago with a certain condition, and nobody could say, who can correct this for me? Who should I see? And he would pick up the phone and he would make a single call, and he would say, you know, just go here tomorrow, just go there tomorrow, and your issue will be sorted. And many of those expressions we heard over the last few days. He was instrumental in bringing medical missions, and before WPP became WPP, he had medical missions running 30 years ago. And because of the man that he was, he never requested or asked for this to be added to his name as the man who was providing access to critical medical services, sometimes at little to no cost to the families and to the children. In the case of the WPP, it's completely without a cost. And the International Hospital for Children, now renamed the International, the World Pediatric Project, was formed out of that project dating back some 30 years. We have now about to file past the body of Sir Frederick. A number of senior persons in the public service and in the medical field and otherwise, and I see a senior magistrate as well, who is in queue to file past the body. Those who are viewing by way of VCU3 television, NBC's Facebook page, and SVG television, you will have the benefit of seeing what is happening while we provide commentary for you. The members of the immediate family have gone to pay their respects earlier, just after the coffin was opened up for viewing. And we had asked as well that we have a permission to, of course, follow the procession, the cortege, and then the procession that will follow his lying in the state at the Assembly Chamber in Kingstown. So we'll continue with coverage from this location until approximately 11 o'clock, at which time we'll break in our broadcast, and we will then allow for the public viewing to take place between 11 and 12 o'clock. We expect to be back on the air with you by way of radio at approximately 12:30, at which time we'll follow the cortege from the yard, the compound of the House of Assembly, down to the Kingstown Methodist Church. When we arrive at the Kingstown Methodist Church, we'll have another team that will be standing by to receive the broadcast, and our General Manager, Mr. Dion John, will take up the baton from the Kingstown Methodist Church and continue with the proceedings during the course of the funeral service. Following that, we'll continue with run-in commentary as the team from the Kingstown Methodist Church will hand over the broadcast to the team on the road. We'll be moving with the procession down to the Kingstown Cemetery for the interment. We expect as well to have the visuals accompanying us. We know that Steve Wallace and his team has been hard at work since we found out about the date for this event, and we'll be pulling out all the stops and making sure that your listening and viewing experience is a fitting tribute to the man that Sir Frederick was and the legacy that he left behind. So we hope that you will continue to stay with us during the course of the day, and we will continue to bring you the happenings as it relates to the state funeral of Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, who served as this country's Governor General, before that as a practicing medical doctor. Abigail, just to note as well, upon becoming Governor General in 2002, Sir Frederick, then Dr. Ballantyne, was called up to be knighted, and he was created Knight of the Grand Cross of the Order of St. Michael and St. George, which carries the title GCMG. So for those who are wondering what is GCMG, it might be a bit confusing as to why we add GCMG at the end of his name. It is because of his knighthood, the Knight Grand Cross of the Order of St. Michael and St. George, which was accorded in 2002, November of 2002. And he has since then quite humbly served as Governor General, 17 years of dedicated service to this country in the capacity of Governor General.
Dr. Ballantyne has made an outstanding contribution to the health sector and the creative arts by bringing several renowned classical musicians and orchestras to perform at Government House and also at the Peace Memorial Hall here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. He was a man who was a lover of music and the creative arts, and a couple of his favorite songs we have been playing on the station for the past couple of days. And he really and truly, he was clearly old school as heart, as we say. I remember seeing him at our annual Love Boogie last year. He was there with his daughter Melissa, and he had a joyous look on his face. Though, of course, NBC's Love Boogie, we were known for all the old school music, and you could have seen the smile on his face as he was, you know, just about to leave the event at the cruise ship terminal last year, that, you know, he looked like he had a really good time enjoying all the back in time music that was being played. So he was really a lover of music and the arts in general. And so his involvement in the creative arts sector as well was known here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. He, as Colvin mentioned, was, you know, very instrumental in the whole effort of medical missions to St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And, you know, any parent, and Colvin could attest, any parent who has a child who has some sort of something wrong that, you know, you need specialized help in those areas, you... Well, I can't say I don't have children, and, you know, but listening to stories, and from time to time we post interviews being done by Nika Anderson Isaacs for the Ministry of Health, of the doctors who come to the medical missions for the WPP, and you hear the stories of parents and children who, you know, are being taken care of through this program. How very amazing it is for them to be able to get treatment that would cost them thousands of dollars. They're able to get it done here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And, you know, this is a part of a legacy that was left by Sir Frederick Ballantyne that will go on, you know, for years and years to come, God's willing. He was appointed Governor General in 2002, and as Colvin was saying, he's the longest serving Governor General in the history of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And just to give you some of the Governor Generals that served, we had our very first Governor General in that of Sir Sidney Gunn-Munro, who had held the office from October 27th, 1979, when we gained independence, to February 28th, 1985. Then followed Sir Joseph Lambert Eustace, who held the office from 1985, February 28th, to 1988, February 29th. He was followed by Henry Harvey Williams, OBE, acting from 1988, February 29th, to September 20th, 1989. He was followed by Sir David Jack, who held the office from September 20th, 1989, to June 1st, 1996. Sir Jack was followed by Sir Charles Anchorvas, who held the office from June 1st, 1996 to June 3rd, 2002, who then handed over briefly to Dame Monica Dakin, acting from June 3rd, 2002 to September 2nd, 2002, who then fully handed over the office to the late Sir Frederick Ballantyne from September 2nd, 2002. Very recently, July 31st, 2019.
And if I recall, if my memory serves me right, Abigail, the last time we had a state funeral, at least a funeral of this magnitude, was on the passing of the Governor General before that, which was Sir Charles Anchorvas, who passed away in March of 2002. And he was also accorded a state funeral, much like what is being done here today. But then I was still in school. That was about 18 years ago. And but I do remember the occasion and what led up to it in terms of the preparations and the state of mourning that we were in. And now, 18 years later, we had to do another of this. Hopefully, we wouldn't have to do any more of these in the not too distant future, but as it may, the Lord has his plan for everyone, and Sir Frederick by no means did any less that he wanted to do for this country, and he served to the best of his ability. And I'm sure in his mind he would have said, you know, I could do. He was convinced that there was more that he could have done. But we'd know that after 83 years on this earth, there's a point where we have to rest. And it was an appointed time to leave us. It's not anything that anyone would want to face. Any family, any daughter, any son, any sibling. To stand on an occasion like this and look at the final mortal remains of your loved one lying there, after being so much of a jovial person, after being a person who reasoned, who spoke so highly of life itself and of people that he interacted with, but to look at his mortal remains is a difficult one. Now we have the members of Parliament. We have Senator and Deputy Speaker Carlos James and Minister Frederick Stevenson. Senator Deborah Charles has also just paid her last respects as well. Clayton Bergen, who was a former Member of Parliament and who has served this country as well at the level of Parliament over the years. And as we get closer to 11 Abigail, there are other persons who we will see file and pass and paying their last respects to Sir Frederick. And as we continue to bring you coverage of the laying to rest of a son of the soil, a man who we wouldn't be able to amply describe in words to you. I mean, we knew him to an extent, but not to the point where many persons knew him, especially his family, who knew him all their lives, and have a greater understanding of the man that he was. He held many persons dear to him, and he also had some very good friends that looked out for his interest, just as how he had his children. And over the last few days, we've also heard from a few of those persons who reflected on their interactions with him and his impact on their lives individually. I know that persons who shared, some didn't get the opportunity to call in, as I mean, we had so many calls on Sunday, and there was only that many calls that we could have taken. But persons sent WhatsApp messages, and those who posted notes on our Facebook page, who sent messages to our Facebook page. We are aware that you wanted to pay your respects, and we appreciate you sharing with us. We unfortunately were not able to share every single one of them, and for that we of course apologize that you didn't get to have your input as well. But as it may, the magnitude of the contribution of this man is simply one that we expectations and the persons that would provide their memories and their recollections will be so much so, and it's hard to keep up. Now, paying his respects to Sir Frederick is the leader of the opposition, the Honourable Dr. Godwin Friday and Mrs. Friday, accompanying him as well, members from the opposition side in Parliament. We have now Pilot Fine and Pass, Honourable Sinclair Leacock, and also with him other members of the opposition side of Parliament. And as they move towards the family and pay their respects, we see Honourable Terence Oliver as well, who is paying his last respects. Senator Barnwell, Zita Barnwell, who has just passed the mortal remains of Sir Frederick, Honourable Daniel Cummings, and other members of the opposition side, Mrs. K. Marcus Batisse and Mr. Lauren Batisse, Honorable Lauren Batisse, was also a member of parliament. Shortly, we will have the conclusion of this portion of the viewing, the one that is allotted to the officials and close relatives of the deceased, and the public will then have their time to share their sentiments, to express their grief and provide support to the family. It is already overwhelming, and it's not even to the point of the public coming here. I know many of the members of the family would want to receive your sentiments and your expressions of grief. However, we must understand as well that the time is one that is very difficult for them. And as much as they appreciate your grief, it may be overbearing at times for them to keep up with what is happening. Especially, I know the daughters have been taking this very hard. And after interacting with them, I know that it is not a regular burial for them. It's a man who they respected greatly as a father. And he was a father figure for many as well. He was a father of 8 children, but as someone said, he had so many adopted children. They were countless. There's just no way of adding names to those individuals. About to file pass, and now we have Mrs. Gordon McGill, who served as this country's Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Education in the previous administration, and also the Minister responsible for Agriculture, the Honourable Saboto Caesar. He too, along with Mrs. Caesar, just paid their last respects to Sir Frederick. In a few minutes from now, we will close this portion of the broadcast by way of NBC Radio, and we will resume at approximately 12:30 as we prepare to transition and for the cortege to be moved from the House of Assembly down to the Kingston Methodist Church. And Abigail, we were told that the funeral of Sir Frederick will be quite different to the funerals we tend to attend. That is, a lot of narrated tributes. He was a man who loved music. You mentioned earlier in your commentary that he loved orchestra, he loved hymns. He just loved music on a whole, and he had a great appreciation for live music. The Police Band entertained him, previous the Borussian Quartet entertained him, and he was a man of excellent musical taste, as my general manager would say. And that will be reflected, I was told, this afternoon as a fitting tribute to his love for music. There'll be a lot of music this afternoon at the Kingston Methodist Church. There wouldn't be a eulogy as you're accustomed to go to a funeral and hear so many wonderful things.
Well, I think if a eulogy was to be done, you know, the funeral would have been difficult, one, and two, I think it would have just been too long. You know, I mean, to talk about this man would have taken up the entire funeral service. You know, so I think, you know, the decision to not have a eulogy, I mean, it would have just been to reflect on his life and his contribution to not just St. Vincent and the Grenadines, to talking about, you know, the intimate way he touched the lives of various people. You know, I really don't think a eulogy would have done him justice.
And even more so, Abigail, we were actually expecting a death announcement, and the decision was taken that as simple as possible, we state that he has passed, that he will be lying in state at the house, the procession, the funeral service, and the burial. And that is how simple of a man he was. It was his last wishes. And he requested of certain things, and his family went the extra mile in making sure that his last wishes were honored. And today, he is lying in state in a coffin constructed from breadfruit wood, as he so requested and so left in the charge of his family. And it is the least that could be done for him, as to the man he was, and as a fitting way of remembering the man that he was, and of his service, his human service to the people of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the people of the world, might I add. We've had persons from Australia, from the Far East, from the United Kingdom, from the USA. He had very very close relationships with his medical colleagues in Virginia, and I know that their group of medical doctors and those who were integral in the process of making sure that the medical teams of flow smoothly between the United States and St. Vincent and the Grenadines for the medical missions, they too have joined in with the kind words and the expressions of sorrow on the passing of this man. Some of them are actually seated here today with the family, and I'm believing that others will join at the funeral service and the interment later on today.
And we have to mention as well that he was the patron of the Lions Club, the St. Vincent and the Grenadines Cricket Association, the SVG Red Cross, Sir Optimus, and many, many other organizations. So it wasn't a case where, you know, he was just a medical doctor and he loved music and he was the Governor General. He was involved in so many organizations, and of course, hence the reason that so many persons were able to interact with him on such a personal level. And I mean, well, I don't know how it is for other countries, but for me, I'd say that our Governor General was one that was very, very personal. You know, he was very approachable, and you know, of course, he had his security details and so forth. But, you know, it was a man that you could go up to and literally shake his hand and say, "Sir, how are you?" and have a little conversation, you know, which was really interesting. You know, he was always ready to have a conversation with you, you know, and as I said, that someone made the comment I heard on Sunday in our tribute program, where he always had this smile under his grey moustache, you know.
And signature moustache.
His signature moustache. And I mean, he is just really and truly such a gentle soul.
Yes. And to add to that, someone also said that he was the textbook image of a grandpa, you know, with his signature moustache and his beard. And he just had that grandfather figure look. And when he visited the primary schools, I believe the Windsor Primary School is mentioned, and other schools, you know, the young ones will see him as grandpa, you know, a grandfather figure. And so too he was for many, a father figure, a grandfather figure for so many. Just to add to your comment, he was probably one of the more easy accessible senior officials, I know. I mean, to have to literally talk to him on the phone without having to wait for an appointment. He was a man of that nature. I was pleasantly surprised when he agreed to sit down just to talk, just to reason about, you know, his life. And we spoke about things, and many of which he wanted it to become public knowledge. It was just that he liked to talk about his formative years when he was growing up, and the family, the fact that he was the only child of his parents. And he didn't see that as being, as persons would say, born with a gold spoon in their mouth. He took every bit of education, support, whatever was provided by his parents, and turned it into his life and his work and his contribution to his country. And it was interesting to learn so many things that on a on a personal bit, you wouldn't sit down with a Governor General and talk about these things. But as you mentioned, he was a very personal gentleman. And he always liked to talk, to reason about things, reality, things happening around, and family and the importance of family. And by no means his name will be forgotten, by no means, I'm sure, now that there's a wing of the Trinity Medical School that was named in his honor, his name will continue to live on, and I'm sure that he'll be honored in other ways with his name. And maybe it was not something that he even wanted, knowing the gentleman that he was. He preferred to do his work quietly, without any fanfare. But where credit is due, we give him the credit. Just a few minutes remain in Abigail, about 2 minutes or so before we wrap up this level of our broadcast.
You know, I don't think a lot of persons really thought about, you know, well, for those persons who didn't have the privilege of meeting him on that personal level, some persons may have only, you know, seen him as he passed by in his vehicle, or, you know, on special occasions, in special events that he would attend and so forth, but persons never really got that opportunity to meet him personally. And I think a lot of persons may have seen Sir Frederick, as Uncle Colin, Uncle Freddy, as, you know, a person that is above their reach and outside of their reach. And, you know, from hearing all of the tributes and hearing all of the things and that persons would say about him over the past couple of days, and reading some of the information that is being posted online and so forth, I think he is a true representation that you can do anything you put your mind to. You know, it also says to me that helping people in love is something that will be remembered forever. You know, and that was what he did. And from all the tributes that we've been hearing over the last couple of days, is just how he served and helped others, which I think is pretty much the tune that a lot of persons are singing, that he was such a helpful person, and his service to St. Vincent and the Grenadines and its people. He will indeed be dearly missed, but, you know, someone else was saying that, and I said this morning, I really hope that we all take a page out of his book and learn to emulate some of these amazing attributes he had, even for especially, I should say, for young men today, to emulate some of the things that he carried throughout his life. Someone mentioned this morning his punctuality at events was something that they admired. So, you know, all in all, from me, Colvin, I was happy that I was able to meet him. I was happy today to find out that he enjoyed my program. I would have loved to have said to him thank you. I'd have loved to say to him thank you, and, you know, wish him all the best. And I sincerely hope that he rests in peace, and that his family, you know, out of all the outpouring of love from the public, that they will feel at ease and be comforted by the words and expressions of love from all of us in St. Vincent and the Grenadines and around the world.
Indeed. And I'm not sure if there's any more that I can add to what was said there, Abigail. There's just so much that we can say as expressions on our end as to the man that who he was. As a matter of fact, I'm looking across from where we're sitting, and there is a painting of him hanging on the wall of Parliament. And for those who look at our feed of Parliament, sometimes you would see the camera fixed on a painting of him. And, you know, just to look at his composure, the way he, you know, he walked, the way he had a signature way of folding his hands, not in a rude way, but it was just his way, a comfortable way for him to stand, an expression for him. We're having a change of the guard now. The two guards of honor in mourning position are standing in front and behind the immortal remains of Sir Frederick. As we get ready to close this portion of the broadcast, we know that you will be following us. We wish to thank you for joining us for this event today. We will continue with our broadcast at approximately 12:30 by way of NBC Radio, and I do believe the other media houses will join in as well. VC3 Television, SVG Television, Star Radio, just to name a few of those that are with us. The live stream will continue as well on our Facebook page, facebook.com/NBCSVG. And as we prepare for the public viewing of Sir Frederick, the late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, we say so long, and we encourage you, if you can, to come and pay your respects, dress appropriately, and of course be very respectful to the family in this time, and just abide by the rules that are in place as it relates to his viewing and paying your last respects. Thanks to our audio team. Rennie King played a role in this as well. Javed Roberts, our driver, shilling for Douglas. Our on-air team, myself, Colvin Harry, Abigail Haynes, and Jabal Frank at Master Control. On the video end of things, thanks to Steve Wallace and his team from STV Online, and also Zero Bennett of VC3 Television on his end with his team as well. A collaborative effort in making sure that you get end-to-end coverage as well. We'll resume with our broadcast at approximately 12:30, and we hope that you will indeed join us then. Until we meet again via the airwaves and online, here's wishing you a good morning.
late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, who served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest. Jordan Road. Jordan Road.
When I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My brother, you ought to bend there. Yes, my lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Jordan, roll. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die. To hear old Jordan roll. My mother, you ought to bend there. Yes, my lord. The city in the kingdom to see old Jordan.
Thank you.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, who served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Andrews. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road. Rule Jordan Road. Rule Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My brother, you are to bend there. Yes, my lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor-General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My mother, you are to bend there. Yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom to see old Jordan. Jordan, 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 oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to see old Jordan roll.
Thank you.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, who served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelos. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road. Rule Jordan Road. Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. My brother, you ought to been there. Yes, my lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor-General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dakin, who had been interim Governor-General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Oh, I want to get you heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Rose. My mother, you ought to been there. Yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom, to see old Jordan Road. Road Jordan Road. Road Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to see old Jordan rule.
Thank you.
Rose.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Bantine, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacon, who had been interim Governor General after the